about to be recycled. Your only chance to survive or evacuate is to leave with us.
Heaven's Gate mass suicide left the world both horrified and fascinated by what happened inside a Rancho Santa Fe home.
39 people between the ages of 24 and 72 committed the largest mass suicide ever on American soil.
They killed themselves inside their rented Rancho Santa Fe mansion over a period of several days in small groups. They put on matching black pants and shirts and black and white Nikes, took phenobarbital mixed with applesauce washed down with vodka. Then they put plastic bags and purple shrouds over their heads and died in their bunk beds.
They all belonged to a space cult that nobody heard of at that time, Heaven's Gate.
Hello and welcome to the All Seeing One podcast. My name is Kyle J. Macias, a researcher, artist, and aficionado of knowledge. Co-hosting with me today, as always, to share some knowledge and understanding is Fernando Inaharmony. How are you today, Fernando, in this Halloween season?
Very well, very well. And you?
Doing pretty good. So today's topic and title of this episode is Heaven's Gate and the False Elohim. Was Jehovah or Yahweh an alien intervention? And before we dive into it, Fernando, tell people about what you do and who you are.
Well, I'm a counselor and composer, musician. I help people to find themselves using the connection with our true abilities, our true virtues. And I describe this as an incorporation into the tree of life, the original reality. And I speak much about this in the channel, YouTube channel, Inaharmony, and also in the blog, themusicofwisdom.blogspot.com, and in the web, they can also leave messages there. It's inaharmony.wixsite.com/inaharmony, E-N-A, harmony, as it sounds, without the H. I'm very, very glad that you and many others are connecting and that a global net of light is growing and people are waking up to a broader understanding. So thank you very much for opening this opportunity with this program.
Oh yeah, I believe that there's something happening in the spirit realm, the different astral worlds, and overall, there's a coming together. And there's also like what I feel like God's given me a vision of is if you could picture the planet, I feel like there was this haze, this demonic haze or this dark smoke screen, if you will, around the whole planet. And I feel like us light workers, but we're not really light workers, but for lack of a better term, people that are from the primordial source are poking holes in this smoke screen and letting light in again. And I'm sure you know about this too, you know, chemtrails and contrails are kind of that they kind of put metals in the air that darken the planet. So that in itself is trying to limit light on this planet as well. That's kind of going on a tangent. We could talk about that maybe, but today's topic is focusing kind of on the cult Heaven's Gate, but also the connection with the false Elohim, the where the law came from. Because I noticed even this cult, Heaven's Gate, the founder, Marshall Applewhite, and he called himself Doe after a while, he talked about the law too. And he had some kind of, when I watched his tapes, he still kind of had truths of things. But it's clear that he had a reptilian attachment or an amphibian alien, interdimensional alien thing. And for people that don't know, if you do the research on aliens, going back into the probably to the 50s, 30s, and even beyond that back in history, you know, aliens seem to be more interdimensional and they're not so much from far away galaxies. I think it's both. So Fernando, I respect a lot of your research and a lot of your downloads you've received from, I would say the father, I would say the real father, I guess, because there's like a false trinity too that runs this universe. What would you say the law, was it given by actually the Yahweh God, Father God, or was it actually an alien race as Zachariah Sitchin proposed?
Well, the law, as it is understood, in scripture, was given by angels, messengers. This is even in Hebrews 2, versicle 2. The word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience receive a just recompense of reward. And this was something established by angelic architects in order to bring certain order into humanity. But it doesn't come from the primordial father. He doesn't give carnal laws full of regulations and rituals. That belongs to the world of creation, where different architects known as Lord God or the lower Elohim, lords of nature, rule. And they are not necessarily aliens as we understand them. Some of them are simply archangels and messengers that constitute the soul of the planets and the soul of the stars, like archangels. But they obviously generate conditions and species that have become the hybrids and the aliens. Even the Adamic consciousness incarnated in some of the species that they made, and this generated a sort of group of entities that can appear as aliens and give teachings and regulations in themselves. They play the role of gods and lawgivers as well. So there is a distinction between different architects and then the hybrids that rule as gods. The gods of the nations, that's the 70 nations mentioned in the scripture. And the Lord, known as Jehovah, would be rather the lower manifestation or copy of the true living master, the tree of life, which is pure being, and it has nothing external. Whereas the Jehovah God, or the fallen Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, has already a distinction between outside and inside, and creation, destruction. That's why in ancient religions, you find the lower trinities, creator, destructor, and sustainer, like in Brahma, Shiva, Vishnu, Anu, Enlil, and Enki, which are the lower father, the lower son, and the lower Holy Spirit, if you will.
The it's interesting, like the law, you know, a lot of people preach the law that it was given by God, and then Jesus came to fulfill that law. What would you say to that?
Well, he fulfilled it because it's perfect. We as emanated beings have no sin in ourselves, and then the fulfillment was already made since the very first time divine life was used by architects in order to perpetuate their world of recycling and hierarchies. So when we are manifesting our true soul, then everything has been paid. We don't have to make reincarnations and rectifications by means of rituals, meditations, and all sorts of techniques in order to purify the soul, because the true original soul is pure. It doesn't have sin or mistakes. The problem is that when we attach ourselves to a law, then we identify ourselves with this, the carnal nature, the shadow nature, which obviously cannot pay anything. And this is the problem. Many people think that they are separate from the true Messiah, which means understanding. Messiah means there is understanding. And this understanding begins by realizing that we have a divine life in ourselves, which is pure. And this pure force is what cancels any transgressions. And it can even harmonize and immortalize aspect of our human personality, reintegrating that personality into the tree of life.
Amazing. Yeah, what I want to get into is the connection. I've sent you a link if you want to check your email real quick. The connection with the Heaven's Gate. I'm just fascinated. I'm not a believer in what he's saying, but I've always been fascinated with cults. Like another famous one was the Jim Jones cult, Jonestown, how he forced them to drink the Kool-Aid and they all died. It was a mass suicide or killing in the United States. Another one that we're talking about today is Heaven's Gate. And that one was more interdimensional, talking about aliens and how, you know, Jesus came from the level above human and the evolutionary level above human. And these initiating tapes are very interesting too, with their leader who called himself Doe. Fernando, let's take a watch real quick, like maybe 30 seconds, and I want your input.
I judge you. I don't care to judge you. You will judge yourselves by what you do with what we have to say, by what you can accept and what you can't. It's almost better that you never see me or hear what we say, for that will put you to the test of whether or not you will condemn me, whether or not you will judge me. You cannot hurt me. You cannot hurt these. We do not judge you. It's funny that the world, the mainstream...
Let's stop it there. You know what's interesting is I feel like maybe this dark algorithm is kind of talking to us a little bit because I just chose a random part five of that that initiation tape, and he's all saying, "Do not judge us. We do not judge you." It's almost like interdimensionally the aliens or the algorithm saying still trying to confuse people, like almost like deception still runs the deception algorithm, and you could tap into it. Fernando, in that initiation tape with Heaven's Gate, to me, when I first watched it, you know, I've seen a freaking alien possessing a human guy. The guy is not there no more. He's absent. And I just see an interdimensional alien behind those eyes and even his mouth and the way he speaks, it draws you in. And I notice anything from the dark side really seduces you into it. It makes you feel good. It draws you in. It kind of sedates you. They kind of sedate you a little bit. What do you think is going on here, Fernando, with Heaven's Gate?
Well, I totally agree with you. This man gives very weird vibes. I think he's not human. Something alien or strange is talking through him. And if you pay attention, it's like a robot. And his eyes doesn't have the usual human depth. It's what we would call a psychopath. And there is definitely something trying to deceive in order to feed on the energy of those blind believers. They are not necessarily aliens from a higher world. Maybe they are just demons from these dimensions and are lying because they are professional liars. I don't believe anything they are saying. Even if they mention a kingdom of God, then they are not necessarily referring to the kingdom of the Lord God. That there is a collection of architects that can be called that way. So they would even be lower in dimension than that.
It's interesting because you mentioned they're not alien. So what would be the difference between the aliens of the higher world and demons?
But demons is someone that has a character. Demons comes from daimon, which means character in Greek. But remember when in Genesis 2, for instance, the so-called Lord God wanted to implant the Adamic soul into different species to find an appropriate helmet. But Adam did not find the appropriate helmet. However, Adam gave name to the species designed by those architects. And that's when the Adamic consciousness blended with different creatures. And that was the origin of what we call aliens. They have insectoid aspects, amphibious aspects, reptilian aspects. And they have a spark or atom of Adamic consciousness. But they are not necessarily very evolved. Some of them might have technological advancements, even some sort of spaceships, but all that came from previous worlds, I think. Most of the species mentioned in that place can seem like aliens coming from other planets or other dimensions, but I don't think they come from that far. They are liars. Many of them simply say that because they want to deceive. Even though, as I'm confirming lately, some of them want to be reintegrated or forgiven. And they try to teach what they consider to be good things to humanity. But obviously they don't have the right to do so because our true master is the original blueprint, the Adamic blueprint, which comes from the DNA of the primordial father. So in any case, we have the right to discern and even judge the so-called angels. That's even in the scripture. But we would be given the power and right to judge the angels, not in a negative way, but as discerning what we are. We don't have to be subjected to anything external because we have the law of life imprinted in our heart and our mind, and that's what we have to manifest.
Yeah, that's what you really awakened me to, actually, is this is the whole, that knowledge, a lot of true knowledge and true wisdom is so much higher and so much above, or I would say, I would use the word beyond. I feel like that's the synchronistic word, actually, I've been receiving, is the word beyond, and that's better than saying higher, you know, because these entities are technically higher than the human race, a lot of these alien races. So I want to kind of keep this episode like half and half. So like I want the half of it to be Heaven's Gate. The other half, I want to explore what we've been talking about and exploring about through email, and what I feel like things are kind of, there's an emanation of something going on here regarding alien intervention. But here's what I think happened with Heaven's Gate. And I want your opinion on this. When I analyze Heaven's Gate, to me, it seems as if there was an outside alien force that maybe visited Earth, or this is their plan, or they've been here. I don't know. I'm kind of thinking it's some kind of species. I don't think it's them as a whole. I think there's a species that came here. They targeted Doe, and I think T was the woman's name. But let's just go with Marshall Applewhite. I think they targeted him because he had a lot of mental illness. If you study the Heaven's Gate cult, he had a lot of mental illness. And what I know, people with heavy mental illness, it's nothing to be ashamed of, but entities can and do take advantage of people easier with mental illness, and they can kind of vibrate at that frequency more than someone who doesn't have that much mental illness. So I think what happened was they used Marshall Applewhite as a vehicle, oddly enough, of what he called himself, he was just a vehicle, as a way of deceiving groups of people, and it's almost like they harvest human beings, and not like the movies, like where they eat them in the physical. I'm talking about they brainwash them in the physical, and then when they harvest them into the astral realms, they feed on their souls, whether it be in the hell realms or different astral worlds. It's a way of getting the harvesting these people. You attract them into this, into it. You, like a snake, you're really good with the tongue. You talk well. You make them feel good. You drag them in. And even watching Apple White's initiation tape, you can see how he was very charismatic, but not the good charismatic. It's almost like this seducing, sensual drag in, and that's where they bite you. Once you die and they take you, that's where they bite you and they get you. They got you. And for some reason, when I dial in with my consciousness, with what happened, I really do sense that, for people that don't know, they believe that there was a UFO inside or behind the comet. I think it's called the Hale-Bopp comet that was passing around 1995. And they said this was their time to leave Earth to go to the evolutionary level above human. So I don't know, when I kind of sensed, Fernando, that they did go on some type of ship when they killed themselves. And it was one of the biggest American mass suicides, which is also interesting, but I don't know why, if I sense it with my awareness, it seems that, these souls did get harvested and they went on a UFO behind that comet or on different planets in our solar system that are astrally controlled by these aliens. But I don't know, I still kind of sense that they're in some type of hell realm or being feasted on or used. What do you think, Fernando? Because I know this would kind of break a lot of people's religious mind that there's only one heaven and one hell. What do you think happened to those souls? Were they harvested or are they being used somewhere else? What's your opinion on that?
Well, there are many possibilities. If those entities are speaking through this crank man were from the Earth, they went just to realms of the Earth. But there are also dimensions where there are heavens. For instance, in the so-called world of Beria, world of creation, there are seven heavens. And the first is called Vilon. And some Kabbalists say that their teachings or some of their teachings come from angelic humanoid beings that inhabit Vilon, which is one of the seven heavens mentioned in scripture. And they bring teachings and even help people to get there, to go above our lower dimensions, because the physical plane is very low and also the astral realm is very low. So there is a higher mental realm where these beings supposedly exist. And I'm convinced they come from there to give laws and teachings. But the problem is that they don't teach the full truth. I come from beyond that because I remember it when I was in the light. And many of my light brothers are also connected to deep memories. And we know many of these teachings are a lie or deceptive because they keep people in the lower heavens. We have our sky heavens and our solar system, but beyond all that, there is an absolute heaven, which almost no one speaks about because it's even mistranslated in the Gospels. The goat spells, the spells of the goat, the spells of the devil, are the mistranslations of the Bible. So that's what many of these cult leaders are using. They are manipulating people by using the old Babylonian and Egyptian way of understanding true teachings. So they don't even have original teachings. They steal everything from our collective body of Messiah. Think, for instance, in the teachings of the Mormon, when Joseph Smith spoke in the early 20th century and late 19th century, he spoke of Moroni, the angel Moroni, who brought teachings. And then many others spoke of the same angel. For instance, Alex Collier, I think the contactee, the man that was having contact with those aliens from, I don't remember the place, but he was speaking about Moroni. So there are sort of alien species that might come from some of those heavens, but they are still within the matrix. All that belongs to the fallen creation, because in the true reality, there is no creation, there is emanation. Everything that is created gets destroyed. And there is no kingdom either. So.
Wow, that's pretty heavy. That's very deep. I want to talk about that amphibian alien Egyptian, going back to the Egyptians again, the amphibian alien story you received recently. Can you tell the listeners that? Because I think that connects even with the Applewhite story, the Heaven's Gate, that there seems to be alien intervention with all these cults. And we'll talk about this after the story, but I feel like cult is a spectrum. Like the church down your street is pretty much a cult, but on the lower part of the spectrum, like if Applewhite and Heaven's Gate's a 10, I would say your church is nearby are probably like a 2 or 3. I feel like they're all kind of cults, because if you attack anyone's belief system and they get aggressive with it, usually if they get aggressive, that's a program speaking. That's not a person speaking. But first, Fernando, let's talk about that amphibian. Do you mind sharing that?
Which one? The amphibian I met in 2012 for?
Oh, let's do both. I think that'd be interesting. But no, both. Let's do both. So you met an amphibian in 2012, which is interesting, that 2012. And then the story you received recently from that person.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I was contacted by a person who gave his testimony of seeing a sort of creature with half human, half insectoid aspects, but having a sort of Egyptian look. And this being claimed to be a female goddess, or no, not a female goddess, a female demon who wanted to get redeemed. And she said that she was going to cure this person because he was suffering from an ailment. And the insectoid creature went to him and did something in the area that was sick. And the insect-like creature told him that this was a way of healing, and he had to learn to do that on his own. And the amazing thing is that he got cured, and doctors did not have an explanation for it. He was asking me about all that, no? And I'm sure this can be true. And this obviously is a proof that some of these insectoid beings might have what I said before, an atom of Adamic consciousness. And they want to be reintegrated somehow because they feel they are lost, or they are in a very bad condition for them. And they know they have been playing the role of demons, or at least characters that have interfered with human beings. And now they want to be redeemed. And they give teachings. But obviously, first of all, they don't have the right to give us laws or teachings. And they, in any case, can be redeemed if they go through the stone of Messiah. But I'm not in a position to tell them how to do that. I have the impression that some of those beings might have a type of soul that when they die can be somehow reincorporated into some human beings, somehow. and through the human soul, they can be regenerated or recycled, at least with some of the beings I've met. I've never met a friendly insectoid being like this person. All the insectoids that I met many years ago were very aggressive. But the other one, the amphibious I met in 2012, that was a highly evolved species, at least mentally. He had a mental body. And I have a video about that. I call it my encounter with a Noannes Enki type creature. Because if you recall, in Sumeria, they spoke about Oannes, the god of the ocean, which was related to Enki, the god of waters and wisdom. And the legend says this type of being came from the sea and taught arts and sciences to humanity. Now, I'm not sure they are referring to the physical sea. It can be the unconscious of the soul. And these beings, in my view, they come from the Garden of Eden or even previous ages. And actually, in 2012, well, while my body was sleeping, I found myself in a sort of flying long vehicle, which seemed to me like a public transport. And I was communicating mentally with a very beautiful, tall, amphibious-like being with a very thin neck and two holes to breathe. He was very similar to some of the beings depicted in the late Star Wars movies, but I had never ever seen a creature like that. It was very beautiful and very gentle. And he was releasing information into my mind. And it was very interesting because he was always addressing my will. He never imposed anything. He said, do you want to know this or do you want to know that, this particular aspect of the cosmos? And I always nodded. I wanted to know what he was saying. And he seemed very friendly. And at some point of the conversation in that vehicle, the vehicle stopped and we got off. It was like a flying train. And I saw a very clean sort of pavement full of roads. It was artificial. It was like a city. I don't know where the light was coming from. I guess all that might be part of the inner dimensions of the Earth, or at least in this solar system. And we started to walk along one of these paths, and he continued to release information into my mind. It was a huge amount of data, most of which I forgot later on, but I remember some of the things he said. And as we were walking, we saw another group of amphibious beings that belong to the same race than this being. And they look at us in a very strange way. I sense telepathically that they were thinking, what is he doing with that human? And he didn't say anything. He just continued speaking to me in a very friendly way. And the thing that I remember the most was the last images that I received and the last words. He showed to me like sparks of light or tiny lights coming into one planet. And he said, souls incarnate into planets to experience zero point density. And then I woke up. At that time, I didn't know what to make of all these ideas and this experience. I knew it was real. It wasn't a dream. I was communicating with this species. And I thought he was referring to something like the wisdom of Buddhism, and like the soul that dissolves into a sort of void or zero point energy. And at that time, I didn't find that very new, or I started to wonder what he meant. Later on, I realized that all that's part of the classical teachings of the Nagas, the famous serpent beings that sometimes appear as amphibians, or they are described as amphibians. And I started to realize that it's these beings who teach those things. And my conclusion is that they don't have a brain system that allows them to understand what we can understand as humans, because we have a three brain system that can tune in with the harmonia of the true cosmos. And these beings, I think, they have some blockage in the mind. They have an extraordinary mental power, because I remember he could release huge amounts of data into my mental body. And I was astonished about the things he showed. But I realized that's his view, or at least his perception of the universe, his world, his religion. I remember they had a sort of uniform, not this being that was walking with me, but the other comrades, his fellow. They had a sort of military garment, very tight to the body. And I felt they were kind of a squad, or part of an organization or corporation. They were beings that acted like in a team or in a military system. And over time, I realized this being might be trying to teach those humans to acquire a different wisdom that deviates them from the true human purpose. Maybe not with that intention, or maybe with that intention, I don't know. But in any case, it's important to discern the truth from the false. We don't come here to experience any zero point density, because at least some of us come from a place where there is no density of matter. That I explained that in the video in YouTube. There is density of matter and density of energy. So what was referring he? I don't know if he knew that distinction, because zero point density of matter is absolute density, solid experience. But zero point density, or the other way around, zero point density of matter is absolute density of vibration, which is our true nature, our true spirit of life. But zero point density of a spirit is complete solidity, because there is no vibration. So his words were very deceptive. And it reminded me to the philosophies of zero point energy, which mix up quantum mechanics with spirituality. And they all look for this zero point energy, the source of all energy, which was actually the source of the technology used by ancient civilizations. They use the zero point energy, the energy of the vacuum, in order to build up constructions that not even modern humanity can build. And according to Michio Kaku, the advancements of civilizations can be measured that way, because he takes that from another scientist who created a sort of a scale of advancement. And I think those species have reached a level on which they can even manipulate certain dimensions, or even the weather, but I'm not sure they can go beyond the stars. Not even beyond our physical Earth. So I think they are trapped and they don't know how to get out. The only way to get out from them, from these dimensions, would be to die and incarnate into a human being. But as I said, I'm not sure this can be fully possible in all beings. Maybe it can be possible in some humans to acquire some kind of soul of that kind, but if they have the true Messiah, they won't be able to coexist with someone that has that living Messiah within. We wouldn't be able to receive a soul from that type of alien. And that's basically what I think about this experience.
So what do you think's going on? Like, are all these species of aliens deceivers? All these reptilians, amphibious beings, insectoids, interdimensional beings, and these astral realms or lucid realms, do you think that they're all deceiving, or are they misunderstood with how the universe works and the tree of life and how God works? Because it seems that there's always a hint of deception in all these alien stories. But I don't think it's logical to say that, oh, all aliens are evil and demonic either. I feel like that's kind of closed-minded and stupid as well, idiotic. What do you think?
Well, I think they are deceiving in different ways. Some of them might not have evil intentions, but they have a vision of the world which is not true. And, well, that's their problem. We might be able to help them. That's why it is said that Yeshua descended to the lower realms to communicate the truth to the spirits that are incarcerated. Maybe some of the Adamic species that fell a long time ago are part of some of these beings. But obviously there are many others who work for the dark corporation, and they want to bring humans away from the true Messiah. Actually, I'm every day more clear about a plot, a sort of conspiracy, if you will, even though it's not a conspiracy because it's open. But if you notice, in ancient cultures, they all speak about messiahs or anointed ones. The first Adam was the first aborted messiah. He wanted to be a sort of possessor of wisdom, and he was meant to be a messiah, the anointed cherub, as it is mentioned in Ezekiel 28. But this anointed was aborted. That's an interpretation of first Adam, no? The first anointed cherub. Even though it's more complex than that, I don't want to go very deep now into this, but notice how in Egypt, they also spoke about the pharaohs as being anointed, and they were sort of messiahs. And the kings in the ancient world were also called anointed ones, like King Cyrus. And this is because there are entities or even beings, it's not the same entity than being, that want to bring a false idea of the Messiah, the anti-Messiah, the Antichrist, as you want to call this deception, and is to stop the process of salvation of the true Messiah. And I can sense the false Messiah has been acting in all religions. Even in those who in principle receive true teachings. All Abrahamic religions were deceived. That's even in the scripture. The Israelites fell in Egypt, they worship the golden calf, which were teachings from Orion. The calf, the bull, the cow are sacred animals in Egypt, India, and many other places, because the souls that came from Orion, Sirius, gave and certain teachings. And they are aliens, but incarnated in human beings. Those are different types of archons or rulers. They are beings, they are not entities, and they come from other star systems. So they can be called aliens, but are living as humans. And they live as priests, masters, ascended masters, as they were called by theosophists. And they presented a false idea of the Messiah and even the so-called Lord God, which is the sort of replacement for the true being, the true Holy One. That's why I avoid using the expression God for the Holy One. God is part of the external side, and sometimes it's good. There are architects which are positive, and they are part of the God that helps. But there is also a negative side of the godly external nature. So it's a very wide, complex subject, and it's very easy to get lost if you don't have the details in mind.
Yeah, I noticed talking to you and also in my own research, if you go deep into the down the rabbit hole, at least in this matrix, it could be like taking a hallucinogen, almost like taking shrooms or DMT, dimethyltryptamine, or it can kind of give you the same information and knowledge, can kind of give you the same creepy effect as if you were to take a drug that were to expose you to this matrix of what's really going on. That's why I feel like some minds that aren't ready for this information kind of do go crazy or deny it its truthfulness because it's just too much to handle. So Fernando, I'm very interested in your research with fallen angels and how they're trying to, I always kind of sense that actually in doing my own research. It was the opposite of what the churches I used to go to preached. But I kept in my research with demonic entities, alien entities, studying them as if I'm a scientist. It does seem that some of these fallen angels, which is separate from the demonic stuff, seems to be trying to win back their place in the primordial source, or trying to win back their place in heaven, or even the ancient scriptures talks about this. The Bible, some people call it the Bible, they talk about this. The scriptures talk about this, that the angels who didn't keep their first estate. So are there fallen angels that are trying to win their salvation back? I'm trying to use different vocabulary, but they're trying to win their estate back, their place.
Well, as far as my research goes, inspired by the mind of the Messiah, these messengers or angels that abandoned their place were part of the parts of Adam, the soul of Adam, that did not fall in the first fall, but fall later on when they join the daughters of men. And they abandon their place or their spiritual realms in order to become messiahs themselves. So they made the same mistake made by Adamic species in the Garden of Eden, because they wanted to rule over this physical kingdom before they were ready, before they had the spiritual understanding. And they disconnected themselves from the holy intelligence. Actually, there are passages in scripture which say they came with an attitude of arrogance. For instance, there is a Psalm, I don't have it in mind, I think it's Psalm 108 or something, where the angels say, "Who is Enosh so that you praise him?" Enosh is the type of Adam that we are as human beings now. And there are different types of Adam. The Adam in the Garden of Eden was Adam Nefesh Haya, which was very spiritual. And it was inhabiting realms of light that we have forgotten as human beings. Then there was the Adam Isha, the man-woman, which was split into mind and emotions. And that's why it fell and it became Adam Enosh. So some of the species that were inhabiting the previous stages of humanity were those who fell later on because they mix up with us. And that's why in Isaiah 14, it says that Lucifer, the carrier of light, came to be like one of us because they mix up with the human vessels. And these beings were part of Adam, but even from the previous worlds, it's something complex because there was a pre-Adamic world in which the sephirotic spheres, the spheres of the spiritual realms and even the physical realm, fell down. In the scripture, this is known as the kings of Edom in chapter 36 of the book of Genesis. And these kings of Edom lost their wives, their bodies. Only the eighth king of Edom preserved his body. And according to the Hebrew wisdom, he was meant to be the Messiah, the true Messiah. But those fallen kings of Edom are the ones that fell later on. You know what I mean? So they are beings that were somehow reintegrated into a new creation, which was the one made 6,000 years ago, when everything had been destroyed in previous civilizations, like Atlantis, Lemuria, and many others. But 6,000 years ago, there were beings, spirits, that became souls in order to descend. And some of them didn't have the right to do it unless they had the understanding. They did it before time. That's what it's taught in Kabbalah, in the Zohar. Adam fell before he was prepared because he wanted to be a Messiah. He saw David, the line of David, which is this physical kingdom, and he gave 70 years to David. So he lost those 70 years, and from then onwards, Adam had 930 years. That's the story in one of the Hebrew teachings. And these are the beings that abandoned their state, their heavenly spiritual state, even with pride, because they saw humanity as inferior species, and they thought they could come here and rule and become the masters. And that was the great mistake. But it's very complex because there are a mixture of two types of species, the pre-Adamic and the Adamic. So this has been one of my favorite subjects, and it's not so easy to address in giving just a few details. But that's basically the idea.
You know what's amazing is I've never heard anyone else with this information. The way you research it is just simply amazing. I remember when I came across your work after my sleep paralysis experience, it was basically like a saving grace. It was like, whoa, this stuff is real. And well, I've already been researching this stuff, but when I came across you, I'm like, this guy knows what's up. He knows what he's talking about. Because a lot of people on YouTube, online, and now TikTok and Twitter and stuff like that, they think they know everything just because they've seen one post, you know? And it's kind of sad because some of these posts they're taking information from real people who did research, hardcore research back in the 1800s or even in the Egyptian times. And it's still kind of the dark side, if you will, of the stuff, the wisdom we research. So what I want to do is kind of wrap up the Heaven's Gate and then go into maybe the next 15 minutes and then we'll end the podcast, but more into the other subject of what we're going to talk about. So what do you think, Fernando, interdimensionally, what was going on in Heaven's Gate? If you were to be the all-seeing eye, or if you were to be the higher self and view the whole situation from a above angle, from a bird's point of view, what do you think was going on there? So my opinion and from my research was that it was an alien harvesting going on, but what do you think was going on there? Was it, were they really, you know, are they still being used somewhere else? Was that alien telling them the truth? Was that guy just a psychopath and they killed themselves? What do you think from a high perspective, what was going on?
Well, it could be all of them, unless we were there and witnessing all of the process, it wouldn't be possible to know the truth exactly, but those possibilities are, I think, the ones that we can use to explain what might happen. But definitely they were harvested in the sense that they put their attention and their energy in something which was external. It wasn't their own. And something was eating, because in this world, everything is eaten by everything else. Even the Lord God eats. The archangels eat up love and compassion and prayers. That's why they ask for worship. But the Holy One doesn't ask worship in that way, although quite the contrary. As in Hebrews 1, it said, the Messiah is the one worshiped because he's above all rulers, above all domination. So these people miss that point. They worship some sort of external alien deity, some sort of kingdom, which might be real in some dimensions, but in the Holy One's absolute heaven, there is no kingdom. That's a mistranslation of Malkut, which in Hebrew means foundation, the absolute foundational reality, where there is no king nor queen nor God or Lord God. There is an oligarchy where everyone expresses the fullness of the Holy One, and no one with the true Messiah or the true light would be able to be deceived by one of these cranks or by one of the cranks preaching in pulpits or pastorships or religions. We are all accustomed to all this madness in this planet, which is a madhouse and a farm for beings that claim to be gods and entities who are not even beings, but simply hybrids that are hopeless, and that's why they are evil and they want to eat up those who have life, because they don't have life. So they need to deceive people with doctrines and false ideas in order to have the food that they require. But as I said, we have the authority and we don't have to be food of anyone, not even of the Lord God, which obviously is going to claim our physical body and our astral body, but we are not physical bodies or astral bodies. We are beyond the stellar bodies. Our primordial body is full of life and can even reintegrate our personality, as I said.
All right, so we're going to take a break and then we'll be right back.
The most obsolete idea is go to school, get a job, work hard, save money, get out of debt, and invest for the long term in the stock market. See, why would you save money when they're printing trillions of dollars? The gap between the 1% and 99% is massive. You see, it's not just money. You have to step back and look at the bigger picture.
So what do you do?
In every one of us is a poor person. There's still a poor person inside me. There's also a middle class person, and the middle class person wants security. They want that steady paycheck. And there's a rich person. And they're all inside of us, except that it's not taught. You're taught to go to school, get a job, and get a paycheck. You're not taught to how to get rich. If you read Rich Dad, Poor Dad, my rich dad refused to pay me. He said the paycheck was one of the most damaging things you could take in your life. He says the moment you take a paycheck, you're an employee, and that's the mindset. So my rich dad never paid me. It drove my poor dad, you know, government employee, nuts. You got to pay people. You got to pay people. And Rich Dad was not saying that the paycheck was bad. He says you didn't want to be a slave to money. So as an entrepreneur, you know, if Rich Dad folded, I just start another company. I don't need a paycheck. I don't need anybody to take care of me. If my government doesn't like me, I move to another country because they need entrepreneurs there. Mm-hmm. So the entrepreneur is not so much the business. The entrepreneur is really the mindset and the skill sets and the different set of rules.
All right, welcome back to the All Seeing One podcast. And I just wanted to ask Fernando a couple more questions. And we're gonna transition from Heaven's Gate into what I really want to talk about also, which I believe connects with Heaven's Gate, is the law and where the law came from. We kind of dived into it at the beginning of the podcast, but I want to do something kind of interesting, Fernando, is I have pulled up right here the Leviticus law, or I forgot what Christians call it, but they call it something, but I'm just going to call it the law right now. And I kind of want to read some of these ancient scriptures to you because that's how I view them now. I used to view them like this is the end all be all, and if you don't obey it, you're going to hell, and all this garbage of religious control, and it was a cult. And cult, again, is a spectrum. Just like you were saying earlier, you know, these pastors, a lot of pastors, they're not preaching from the primordial source. They're not channeling the actual God, the actual I am. They're actually channeling aliens or their phantom self that they didn't overcome. At least that's my opinion, that everyone kind of has this phantom self that they grow up with, which the world and the system puts on you all these programs and labels. And if you don't overcome that, you don't become, and you don't develop the Christ embryo inside, you don't become yourself. You become someone else that can be used as a conduit for dark entities. So I really want to read this and get your opinion on what these ancient scriptures actually mean and what the law is actually saying. And what's the purpose of this even being in these ancient scriptures? So I'm going to start with, it's Leviticus 19. That's the famous one that people use for all kinds of things. And it says, I'm just going to start off. It says, the Lord said to Moses, and remember people, when it says Lord there, it's usually actually translated Elohim or Yahweh. It says, the Lord spoke to Moses, speak to the entire assembly of Israel and say to them, be holy because I, the Lord your God, am holy. So Fernando, what's going on here in this situation? Is this the Elohim talking to Moses? Because people should know this too, is that Moses wasn't shocked. I don't think he was shocked when he seen the burning bush. He was, this is actually dark knowledge, dark history, but Moses was, he was a kind of a warlock. He practiced the magical arts before having an encounter with, I guess you would say God, but I don't know. I feel like there's something else going on here. What's going on here, Fernando, with who is Moses speaking to here?
Well, first of all, we have to realize that the level of consciousness that Moses attained, according to Hebrew wisdom, was exactly the same as the level of consciousness that the first Adam had. This is Nefesh Chaya. So he could communicate with the Yud Hevav Hei Elohim, which belong to the sphere of Bina in the Sephirotic tree. And these are architects, archangelic and angelic beings that can rule over parts of their creation in order to establish an order, but they do it with the law of duality. So they say, be good and don't do evil. That's the commandment from the Garden of Eden. Eat from the tree of life and do not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and bad. The problem is that this introduces the so-called free will, which is not free will, because in the true life, we don't choose. We simply are spontaneous and cannot be deceived. But the Yud Hevav Hei Elohim here were communicating to Moshe the old law, as in Deuteronomy 32, when it says, from today, I put life before death. So choose life so that you live. And this is what Jewish scholars follow, even Jewish Kabbalists. They claim, well, we have to follow life and reject evilness because that's death. That's true. So, and evil actions lead to the death of the soul. So they were not lying. The problem is not the things these angels were saying, but the teaching or the structure, the spiritual commandment they were giving is not in tune with the tree of life, where there is no duality, there is no good and evil, because it's beyond all that. There is unicity. We can even turn evil and shadows in conditions of learning to grow and made it disappear completely, because there is no such thing as evil in itself. It's an absence of goodness or true holy oneness, because there is a fallen oneness as well. And these beings, architects, act in oneness. Actually, in the Shema, the Hebrew prayer, we hear that there is a oneness. Shema Israel, Yud Hevavhei Elohim, Yud Hevavhei Echad. That's usually translated as, listen Israel, the Lord God is one Lord, which is mistranslated, because it means that Yud Hevavhei Elohim must be one or oneness with the true Yud Hevavhei, which is the body of the Holy One. And this body is not on the level of existence, of angelic and archangelic existence. It's beyond, in the primordial tree of life, where even some of these beings can be reintegrated. And that's what I think they were trying to do. But there is a huge dilemma why they made this mistake. That's the great contradiction. How is it possible that they were doing something which wasn't not in accord with the tree of life, if they were allowing humanity to eat from the tree of life? Why they were giving teaching? And I think the only answer to this is what Apostle Paul said in Galatians 3:19, when he said that the law was added because of transgressions, until the seed of conscience, obviously, should come to whom the promise was made. And it was ordained by angels, archangels, or messengers of light, in the hand of a mediator. And this mediator in that epoch was Moshe, who had the same level as the first Adam. But even Moses didn't reach the level of Yehidah, which was the Messiah. Yahushua, as you want to call the Messiah, was able to connect with the primordial Father. He wasn't even following commandments of the angels. He fulfilled the law because he was perfect, bringing life. But he could command the angels, as in Hebrew 1 and other passages we learn. And we can learn this in ourselves. We can even go beyond the stage of Moses and the prophets, because we already have a seed of conscience if we have received it, and if we have cultivated to the point of not just baby soul, but at least child soul that can learn and develop the mind of the Messiah. So I think that's, in a general sense, what was taking place. Moses was communicating with some sort of angels, but not with the Holy One directly.
So like the next verse, it says, each of you must respect your mother and father, and you must observe the Sabbaths. I am the Lord your God. And if I go to the Strong's lexicon, and it shows the ancient Hebrew here, when it says I am the Lord, it says the actual translation is Yahweh. So, you know, what's the difference, Fernando, between the Elohim and Yahweh when it says it here? Because it says that it means Jehovah, the existing one. So, I don't know. Here's my theory with some of this, is that I think you're correct. I think this was an angel type of intervention slash alien kind of intervention, but mostly angel, because I believe they kind of knew what they were doing. But I feel like these angels were sometimes used as a conduit for the primordial source father to speak through sometimes, but other times it's these angels trying to bring order. But then again, like, look, I just read below, it says, I am the Lord, your God. And it says the Yahweh rulers, the God right there. Oh yeah. It says Elohim right there. So this isn't talking about the primordial source then, is it, Fernando? It's talking about angels, right?
It's the problem of all these translations is that we have to go to the Hebrew text. In the Hebrew text, there are very definite expressions, and we have to know all the Hebrew names associated to the deity. Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is the vehicle of transmission. It's like a body. You can compare this to a process of pouring water with a glass. The essence, the pure essence of life, is known as Ehyeh, which was means translated as I am, or I am that I am, Ehyeh asher Ehyeh. But this, I will be who I will be, which means the full potential of being and life and love and light. But this full potential needs a mediator, and that's a soul and body, which is actually the Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, which has powers, forces known as Elohim. But this Elohim can move away from the original body and become fallen Elohim. And what takes place with these names is that the Elohim attached to Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh must be of the part that move away, because they are teaching something which is the tree of knowledge of good and bad, not the tree of life. Otherwise, they wouldn't be giving commandments. When the Father came, speaking through the voice within the Messiahs, like Yeshua, he didn't say, follow the good before evil, because we don't have to choose. Say yes, yes, and no, no. But it's not focusing on a law with rituals. So I think they were understanding that there was something wrong, chaotic, and human beings were taking part in it. So they were trying to rectify chaos, but they created more chaos, because the first fall began precisely because they mix up different natures to rectify, to purify or sublimate energies. That's what they do. These archangels want to elevate the vibration of planets by making a species integrate different natures, like the spiritual nature and the carnal nature, because they are part of the body, just as we have cells and an immune system that works with their own mechanisms. But sometimes they make mistakes. Look, for instance, in autoimmune diseases like cancer. Well, I think Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh Elohim are suffering cancer, and their cancer spread to the earth cancer. Otherwise, we wouldn't have these chaos. So the problem starts on some of the heavens, and this is why we can speak of a false Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh Elohim and a true Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh Elohim, the true forces of the Holy One, a true I amness and a false fallen I amness, which is the false ego or self developed in fallen natures. That would be the daimonic characters in humanity, demons, and even angels. So that would be, in a general sense, the idea. We have to be vessels and expressions of the true Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh Elohim, which is the full spirit, soul, and body in the Tree of Life, not in the lower worlds where the fallen mother, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh Elohim, is working. You can sense the difference in the taste, because these writings were transmitted by human beings which were in Babylonia. And I think the problem comes when some teachers try to transmit the teachings of the prophets by using Babylonian language, such as the dual good and evil. For instance, when in Genesis 1, the priests wrote that Elohim, the forces of nature, said, have dominion over the beings of the water, the air, the earth, and multiply, replenish the earth. That's not love. That cannot come from the Holy One. It comes from Elohim, which is translated as God, but it means forces of nature. So it's architects of nature. Then in Genesis 2, something similar happens. The Lord God tells Adam not to eat from the tree of good and evil, eat from the tree of life, but then starts to make experiments to divide Adam, and then even curse the serpent and Adam for transgressing the law. And later on kills, extinguishes the sinful humans and messengers in the bringing the deluge, the so-called Mavul, the catastrophe. So that cannot be the Holy One. That's something that went away, that moved away from the primordial source. And this is why we can call the Lord God as the Mother God. Is the mother generatrix of the matrix. And she has her own laws and regulations based on duality. Sometimes she is evil or negative, and sometimes she is positive. She can even remove presidents and put a good president so that humanity can have some favor. Because there are rulers, there are principalities that rule over nations. And supposedly, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh Elohim rule above Israel, which are the souls that conquer their passions. That would be the Lord God for Israel. But as I said, we have to move beyond love, all these entities, because they try to bring order, but go beyond them and bring the true teaching of the Father of Lights, which is unconditional love, full life, integral conscience, and so on.
So in the situation where Moses comes across the burning bush, the burning tree, and it wasn't being burned up, and it spoke to him, and it said, I am that I am, or I will be what I will be, what was speaking to Moses? Was that the true I am-ness, or was that like what we talked about before? Was that a conduit for the primordial source?
Ehi Asher Ehi is the consciousness that brings you somehow the potential of what we can be fully. Ehi Asher Ehi is I will be as I will be. And I think Moshe, which means over the waters, was already acquiring a level of consciousness that touched the world of emanation, the world of Atzilut, because he could be called Adam. That's what Hebrew wisdom says. They say Moses was the only human that could be called Adam. So the first Adam was Nefesh Haya. What the Jewish Kabbalists don't say is that Yeshua was called the last Adam, so was even higher than that, because he fulfilled the I am that I am, or the I will be who I will be. So the primordial intelligence was telling Moses, I will be in the future, 1400 years from now, the true Messiah will manifest and will establish the true law of life, not the law of a stone that was given to the Israelites because they were worshiping the golden calf. I think this was the problem. They didn't understand. the true spiritual teaching of life, and therefore they had to be taught by means of religion, rituals, commandments, things of the world. I think the problem was of understanding. As Paul said, they had to receive a seed of conscience. And most people were so carnal that they could not develop the true seed of Israel, even though there were great prophets like Joseph, which was the seed in Egypt that grew in Egypt. I think Egyptians got many ideas from those spiritual souls that grew up in the Egyptian culture, and they were Israelites. But later on, the Israelites were taken out of Egypt and they fell because they sensed that they were alone. That's why they said, where is God? Where is our true connection? They missed that. And that's why one of the Hebrew names associated with the infinite Holy One is Ayin, nothing or nothingness, because there seems to be something which is beyond comprehension. And then there is Ein Sof, without limits, and Ein Sof Aur, which is the light of the without limits. And this light is the infinite light that says, I am or I will be. That's the potential that spoke within Moshe, and the potential that has to be manifested in each one of us. We all have this I will be since the very first time we receive a seed of conscience. But when we manifest this seed and spread the message all over the earth, because that's what we as messiahs do, then we can say, I am that I am, because it's the full being who is speaking through us. It's not our fallen nature. It's not the human being. As Paul said, it's not me who lives, but the Messiah, the divine or true understanding who lives through us, the divine mind of the Messiah who lives through us, or through me. And that's basically the message.
And that concludes this episode of the All Seeing One podcast. If you want to contact Fernando, I'll have his information in the show note. You could also visit his YouTube channel, which is Ena Harmony, and that's spelled E-N-A-A-R-M-O-N-Y, and you'll see a Tree of Life as his image. Great material. Until next time, I'm Kyle J. Macias.
And I am Fernando Ena Harmony.
And we're signing off. You guys have a good one. All right, bye-bye.